especial para todos los que hoy estamos acá. Es un día que cada domingo se convierte en una fiesta. Yo les quiero dar en esta mañana la bienvenida a cada uno de los que ya estamos nuevamente estamos aquí en tu presencia, esa dulce presencia que queremos disfrutarla a cada instante. Te amamos, Señor, te amamos porque tú eres bueno, porque tu bondad y tu misericordia son para siempre con cada uno de los acá presentes. Hoy te damos gracias por cada hombre, por cada mujer, por cada familia, por cada joven, por cada niño acá presente. Gracias, Señor, por estar en esta nación, por Guatemala. Hoy bendecimos a Guatemala y a las naciones del mundo. Te amamos, Señor, y hoy invocamos tu nombre. Y te decimos, Señor, que tú eres digno de recibir toda la gloria y toda la honra. Obra como tú quieras en nuestras vidas. Gracias, Señor. En el nombre de Jesús. Amén y amén. Gocémonos en el Señor. Amén.
Buenos días, Access Church. Good morning, Access Church. If you stand with us today, we are so thankful that you decided to be here with us. You that the words are so simple, that it's so reflective of salvation, that just as we meet you here, here again. Not once I am more worthy, not once I sacrifice more, just meet me right where I'm at, again and again and again, because he does. Amen. Right where you're at. Yourself up to hide what's in your past, but to meet me where I'm at, in my sin, in my hardships, in my doubts, in my worries, meet me there. Because that's what the loving God did. Amen? Come on. Maybe I'm the only one excited about this one. That we serve a God that met you where you were at. Where you are at. Come on, church. That's something to get excited about. Maybe it'll just be me this morning. That's okay. But I believe there's a God that came for each and every one of you right where you're at. If you're in this walk to salvation today, let me encourage you that there is a God, I love the phrase, that came down the mountain for you. Came down the mountain for you. He sent his son to die to the world that he created. He became as us. He became flesh. He took all of our sins, all of my future sins, took them upon himself and died for those sins. Died for my sins. Died for your sins. And above all else that we do, above all that we sing, that we say, the one message that I want you to leave with today is the message of salvation, that Jesus Christ, who created you, came to this earth and died for you because he loved you, and without a second thought, he would do it again. Do it again for you. So if you're feeling unworthy today, if you're feeling like you're too messed up, if you're feeling like you haven't done enough to earn salvation, I want to bring you good news that Jesus Christ will meet you where you are. Can't go back to the beginning. Can't control what tomorrow will bring. But I know. The place where you promised to be. Not enough, unless you come, will you meet me here again? Come, will you meet me here again? God, not that it's a building, not that it's a name, a team, but that it's a body of believers here in one accord. If for one purpose, I pray the distractions can be pushed to the wayside for a time, Lord. God, that we can give you our utmost attention this morning. Person that's been searching for you. Maybe they didn't even know that it was you that they needed. God, that you meet them where they're at today. God, for the person that's been here for years and is struggling to continue, to decide to leave, to stay. God, I pray that you meet them where they're at. God, to the person that doesn't know where the next check's going to come in, how they can make their ends meet, God, I pray that you meet them where they're at in a supernatural way. God, to the family who's lost a loved one, God, who's out in the world that doesn't know you, God, I pray that you meet that family member where they're at. That they can come to the realization that there's a God who loves them in spite of them. In spite of their failures, in spite of their shortcoming, that you love them, God. And I pray now for the Christian that's struggling to feel worthy of you, of the calling that you've placed on them, of the position that you've put them in. God, I pray that you meet them where they're at. God, and for the distances that we can't walk, Lord, I pray that you carry us. Lord, that when we look back at those footprints in the sand and we see one, we know that you were carrying us through those situations, those hard times, those hurt feelings. Lord, I praise you this morning. I thank you for filling the gap. For when I saw no wind, you were there with a torch to lead me through the darkness. God, we praise you for that this morning. We praise you for that this morning. Y todo decimos en el nombre de Jesús. Amén y amén.
I gave an invitation yesterday by video. I just felt that there were other people that needed an invitation and that you needed an opportunity to prepare. So we have one person to be baptized today that I know of, but that invitation is still good. If you want to be baptized, maybe you came prepared today, maybe you didn't. I'm prepared. I have extra towels for you and a fresh shirt. So as we baptize in a moment, I want to invite you, if that is still you and you'd like to be baptized, just come and sit on the front of this stage and we'll bring you up one at a time. I say that by faith because I believe that I wasn't wrong, that the Lord has spoken to people to be baptized. It's time to go public with your faith. Last week we had a teenage boy. A couple months ago we had children. Today we have a grown man. God is no respecter of persons. We all need relationship with God that only comes through faith in Jesus Christ. Peter said in Acts 2:38, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. See, there's a combination there. It's not baptism just because everybody else is doing it, or that's some tradition of your family. It is there's a Holy Spirit element, and as we just sang, come Holy Spirit. That's been my prayer all morning, come Holy Spirit, because I'm sure not enough. But the work of God, see, in your life, I'm confident that the Holy Spirit, God Himself, present here in this space, not because it's a building, it's basically a tin can. It's nothing fancy. In fact, it's quite hot. We see God's in us. Those who profess His name, God is on the inside. No other religion where the God of heaven comes to reside within. So God within me, God giving me words to speak to you in this moment, in a few more, in a few minutes. But God in you, leading you, imploring you, surrender your life. For many years, I have also been a proponent of getting baptized again. Here's my experience. Sometimes people baptize, it was after a Bible school, they were maybe 8 years old, and mom and dad helped them, and then life happened, and a lot of life happened, and sometimes rebellion, and sometimes regrets, and you come to a new place and a new season in life. And sometimes people take that next step, and they go to Israel, and they get baptized in the Jordan. That's wonderful. I've never had that opportunity. But they want to be baptized where Jesus was. And I don't know if I'll have that opportunity or many of you. But if you're in a new season of life and you've made a new commitment, and maybe you know that and God knows that, and you felt the need to be baptized, I'm a facilitator. It's not for me. It's not for Access. It's a public testimony of what the Lord our God has done within you. That's it. The work of the Holy Spirit, when we repent of our sins, and typically with that, there's some brokenness, guys. There's some emotion with that because there's regret with that. I'll leave that with you, but that's your invitation today. That's your invitation. We have a microphone for my friend here. Thank you, Allison.
Good morning, Access Church. Good morning, everyone. God bless you. God bless you too, Pastor. God bless your family. And God bless my wife. This is a very special moment. Life. I want to share some testimony about my life in this beautiful day in my heart. I was born here in Guatemala in a Catholic family. I was baptized by the Catholic religion, and I also went all my studies in a Catholic school where I learned about God, but I learned about the rules, and I also learned about the limited kind of love God. I went during my life in that relationship with God, but I always felt that was something that I was missed or not having the my best relationship and love to Him. I was that way for many years, and around 18 or 20 years ago, I was having a very hard a dark time in my life, very hard in different issues. And someone told me that there was a Christian church where I can go and begin to go deeper in my relationship with God. So I accepted that invitation, and I went to the church, and since that day, my life began to change. All the feelings that I felt in that Sundays, going to the church and putting in practice what God was telling me during that Sundays, begins to change my life by far. So I was, since that time, knowing more about God and knowing more about His love to us. And also in with ups and downs, because I can tell you that was up and downs in my life, even knowing each day more God in that Christian church. But I was fighting and loving Him every day. And the trigger of my relationship with God was some time ago that He gave me a beautiful treasure. The most beautiful gift that I received from God, and it's my wife. Yes, she's wonderful, and we have been doing our spiritual life together, and we have felt the blessings of God in our relationship. And we have seen miracles since the first date we met. Always, every time we see miracles. And this is the most beautiful that someone can live in a spiritual life. Share the love of God in a family or with your spouse or with someone that you really love. So this time I was always wanting to go farther or higher in my relation with God. So we talk about the Baptist. So we knew about the church, Access Church. So we begin to come here since maybe 4 or 5 months. And we love this congregation. We really love this church because we can feel the love of God from directly from God, from Pastor Fontaine, from his family, and from all of you too. So I make the decision with her to make this commitment to my spiritual life. So this is why I decided to make this beautiful step to have the presence of God deeper in my heart, being Baptist. I know what is this commitment to love Him, serve Him, honor Him in all of my life together with Victoria. So I want to encourage all of you to open your hearts, to open your minds, to open your souls, to receive to divine interruptions of God. To work all your life for Him, because He is the only one that can give us peace, love, for the eternity. So thank you very much again to all of you. I just want to finish these words. sharing with you this beautiful feeling that I'm having today. 57 years ago, September 10th, God gave me life. So now I'm September 10th, I'm giving him back my life. Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Happy birthday, my brother. Let me ask you a question in front of the Lord, in front of all these witnesses, but have you put your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins? And you'll walk with him all the days of your life.
Yes.
And it's going to be an honor here to have baptized you in just a moment. Let's enter this water. Amen. Amen, brother. This is good. This is good. Alfredo and Victoria Lopez, we didn't get that part, but they live on the other side of the city, as do many of you, and they've been coming here, and I know, depending on where you sit in the room, you may not have met yet, but that's who they are, as he shared, a beautiful community of faith, a beautiful church, and I hope that you'll all take time to get to know Alfredo and Victoria and others in the room that you do not know, because God is doing a wonderful, beautiful thing among us. Alfredo, upon your testimony and upon your profession of faith today, before the Lord and in front of all these witnesses, it's my great privilege to baptize you today in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, brother. Welcome to the family of God. Amen. Let's get a picture. Oh, she needs a picture here. I'm sorry. We're ready. Give them an opportunity to take a photo with Victoria as well. And that's your cue to rise and shake hands and be friendly, because I'm going to need a few minutes of your time today. But go ahead, let's go ahead and say hello to your neighbors around you today.
Yeah. Welcome to Access Church. Thank you guys so much for being here today. We're excited that you're here. Just that was an amazing testimony and excited to see what God continues to do today. Entonces, buenos días y bienvenidos a Access Church. Si necesitan traducción para el servicio de hoy, si contamos con sistema de traducción, I think we have a slide. Ahí está. Entonces, pueden pasar a la mesa de bienvenida para tener ese sistema de traducción para el servicio de hoy. If you are new here to Access Church or you've been coming and you just haven't fully gotten connected yet, we have a QR code. We'll have it up here on the screen and it's also on the backs of most of the chairs. You can scan that QR code. That's just a way for you to get connected with us, for us to get connected with you, to fill out a connection card so that we can know who you are and share with you how you can be more connected to the Access community. And one of the ways that you can continue to be connected to the Access family is by joining a small group. We have small groups all throughout Guate, all over, and more are popping up constantly. So we would love to get you connected in that way. Small groups are just a way for you to go deeper throughout the week. So it's not just coming here on Sunday. It's a way for you to continue to be connected. So I think we have the Access Church number as well if you have any questions about that or want to find a small group near you. You can message this number and we would love to connect you with a small group. We have four different ways to give here at Access Church. This is something that we do every single Sunday, and it's a way not only for us to be able to service the Access family here, but the Access family all over Guatemala and really all across the world. So all of the ways to give are up here on the screen. Pretty much any way you could think of, you can give that way. We also have people passing baskets, and we just thank you guys for giving faithfully and joyfully so that we can continue to serve the community of Guatemala. So while we finish up passing the baskets, we are going to go ahead and dismiss our Access kids. So Access kids, you can be dismissed. And again, thank you guys so much for being here today, and we're excited to see what God is going to do this morning.
All right, guys. With the dismissing of the kids, that opens up a lot of seats down here. So, guys, a lot of seats down here. I'd like to invite those of you in the top, if you would come down here. I'd like even my band. Hey, musicians. Hey, band. I got seats for you right here, guys. There's way too much talking up top, guys. You're going to need to come down here. Down here, Axel. Please, guys. Get you a drink of water, whatever you need. But this is, unless you have a screaming baby, that's what that area is for, the gallery, or you need to feed your baby. That's perfectly fine. But there's way too much chatter, and we're in a tin can. So you got to help me help you. Thank you. I had in mind to talk about something different today, but I felt like that I need to speak to you about something totally different than I had planned, and that's what we're going to talk about. And so I wanted to talk to you about choosing sides, and this is something that we will touch on for a few weeks. And it's in light of what I shared with you just for a few minutes last week, but we talked about, for a moment, about pride, because it's pride that prevents us from being obedient. It prevents us from submitting to what God would have for our lives. And so I'm going to pick up there this week. And in context, it's been interesting. I've been able to choose sides here lately myself. I've been in a fantasy football league. And I showed up at fantasy football with just my phone totally outnumbered because those who were serious had their computers, they had spreadsheets, they had all of these things laid out. I was totally unprepared. But they were very serious about choosing the sides that were going to represent their team. They were intent on winning and wanted to stack the deck. That's a card reference. But stacking the deck so that they are victorious and they win. And I thought that is a great application spiritually. That we have the opportunity to choose sides in our lives. And I want you to win. Beyond that, your Heavenly Father wants you to win, wants you to be victorious. And so just as important as it is to choose sides in life when you're choosing for your baseball team or your soccer team or your fantasy football league, beyond that, much more important is who you choose sides for how you live life. And pride is an issue. And so I want to contrast today pride and humility. James 4:6, I touched on this last week, but God opposes the proud, but shows grace, shows favor to the humble. Let's ingest this for a moment. God opposes the proud. That means if you want to be on the pride side, God's in opposition to that. He is not going to be on your side. You're going to be, he's opposing you, in fact. The living God opposing you because you choose to walk in pride. I think that's a big deal. But in opposition to that, he gives grace to the humble. He gives favor to the humble, meaning there's some room to play there. If you'll pursue humility in your life and exhibiting humility in your life, then there is some grace, and I need all the grace I can get. Anybody else? And so if we're in need of grace and we don't want to walk in opposition to what God is doing, and so it becomes a big deal that we choose humility to be on our side, and we don't want to embrace anything that appears to be pride. And yet, I would suggest that it's probably an area in all of our lives that can rise up even on a daily basis. Pride tends to be one of those sins we just sort of brush it off, you know. But it seems God takes pride more seriously than we typically do. Let's look at some Proverbs for a moment. Proverbs 8 and 13. To fear the Lord is to hate evil. I hate pride and arrogance, evil behavior and perverse speech. So to fear the Lord, to honor the Lord, is to hate those things that are evil. And he hates pride and arrogance. And see, this is Scripture speaking, guys, where a world around you will tell you, oh man, you just let toot your horn. You be the guy, you be the gal, you be the one in charge, you be the strong leader. We celebrate leadership, even in the Christian church, and to a fault, I would suggest. It's not always Christian leadership we need, it's Christian servanthood. Not very popular, but I'll stick with that. Proverbs 15. The Lord tears down the house of the proud. Tears it down. Tears down the house. I don't need God opposing me. I don't need God tearing down my house. Anybody? I mean, this is a serious thing. God takes this seriously. Proverbs 18:12. Before a downfall, the heart is haughty, but humility comes before honor. Different versions of that, but referring to our heart, referring to the humility that should be coming, but if not, it's pride, and there will be destruction. Augustine said this, that pride is pregnant with all possible sin. That's a profound statement. I'll say that again. Pride is pregnant with all possible sin, meaning it's ready to give birth to every sin. Pride, arrogance, those things that God opposes. What's going on in your life? What's going on in your thought processes? How were you raised? Pride is dangerous because it's the doorway to all the places in life that we don't want to end up. Pride is the doorway to all the places in life that we don't want to end up. No one in this room wants to end up their life a disaster. But it's through decisions you make, thought processes you have, and thought processes that you allow to play out, and you pursue, you entertain those thoughts, and it becomes an action, and then one thing leads to another, and it's a disaster. And it blows up your life personally, blows up marriages, blows up families, destroys careers, destroys life to the point where we would love to have another chance, another opportunity. It's dangerous. Let me show you Maslow. A lot of you familiar with this. Maslow's hierarchy of needs. You know, you wake up in the morning, you need those basics. Got to breathe some fresh air. Got to have some water. Got to have some food. Get your clothes on. You got to have those things. Then we want to have a job. We want to have resources and health. And we want to own some things. And then there's that need for longing and love, friendship, intimacy. We want to feel good. We want to be respected. We want to have self-esteem. But he placed at the top that it's our desire to become the most that we can be. And that's really that you can just be number one. And this is psychology 101. You've seen this before, many of you. But it's not by accident. You know, you got to have those basic things. But really, he's saying human nature is that you want to be the top dog. You want to be in charge. You want to control everything. You want to be number one. You want to be the best in your field. You want to win at everything you do. But that can lead to pride. Can lead to arrogance. Can lead to many things that are completely contrary to an upside-down kingdom that I often talk to you about. Jesus introduced a whole different deal, guys. But your naturally, your human nature, your carnal nature is going to default to this. He's totally accurate on that. Let me give you a comparison between pride and humility. See, it's very natural for pride to be manifest. But it's supernatural for humility to be manifest, to be exhibited. It's very natural, it's prideful for you to covet others. But it's supernatural to be able to celebrate others. You can easily spot this. There are people here today, you are great, amazing encouragers. I hear from some of you every week, thanking me for something, encouraging me in some way. That see, there it is supernatural. They're able to celebrate other people, but there are other people, surely not you, that covet other people. You perhaps can't praise or celebrate other people. You can't encourage other people because you wish you had what they had. There's an internal battle for achievement. A jockeying for position. The disciples battled that with Jesus. It's very natural. It's prideful. It's natural, number three, to be selfish. You want the best seat at the table. You want the office with the view. You want the biggest piece of lomito. Right? That's natural. That's selfish. It's servant, though, it's supernatural, it's servanthood for you to go last. Trusting that the last will be first, that there'll still be a little bit of lomito left. But you're going to let others go ahead of you. That's operating in humility. It's pride that's always about the glory. This is easy to spot too, guys. Easy to spot those who always want to tell you about all of their great accomplishments. That's what social media is. Look what I did. Look what I ate for lunch. Look what I won. I'm telling you the truth. It's not pleasant. It's not always pleasant what I get to tell you. But I hope it's helpful. Thank you, Michelle. It's prideful to be independent. We all want to be independent. Nobody wants to depend on anybody else. You don't want to depend on mom and dad. There's some good with that. You don't want to depend on other people around you, but you want to be very independent. But it's humility to declare dependence upon God. That you are who you are and where you are because of your relationship with Jesus Christ. That you're seeking to love Him first place and love neighbors as yourself. But you're dependent upon Him. You're dependent upon Him for your health and for your strength and for the resources that He gives you to manage. There's a difference there. And I wanted to just clearly lay these out for you, that you're able to see the differences. But see, humility, how do we get that? Well, humility is the fruit of intimacy with Jesus. And it opens us up to be able to receive His grace. He's opposing the proud. He's giving grace to the humble. Let me show you what intimacy looks like. You got nothing to prove. Might as well be real. Might as well be authentic. I got nothing to prove. I got all my trophies in the closet. I got nothing else I need to win. I can be completely authentic. This is who I am. This is my struggle. This is the things I do well, and these are the things that I do not do well. We have nothing to hide. Transparency. I'm open. This is where discipleship, those two, three, four, coming together. You can have an intimacy that you cannot have in a group of 20 or 30. And you can be transparent with those people. It is a reflection. It is fruit of your intimacy with Jesus. There's nothing to lose. I can be vulnerable. There's nothing to lose here. I am who I am. I am a child of God. It is because of Christ's work on the cross. It is not anything that I have earned. I am not perfect, but I am pursuing Him. I'm seeking to love God. I'm seeking to love others. The love of God flowing through me. This is what intimacy looks like. I've thought about all of this week and wondering, well, how can I best illustrate this? And there's lots of opportunities within Scripture, but I leveled on Luke chapter 15. I want to touch on a few things today as Jesus talked about a parable of that which was lost. There were tax collectors and sinners gathering around Him, Pharisees, teachers of the law. And they were muttering among themselves that this man, Jesus, He welcomes sinners and eats with them. And so Jesus goes into a parable and He gives first of all the parable of the sheep. And describes how that the shepherd goes after the one. He's got 99, but he goes after the one. And his audience can understand that kind of value. And so he's able to connect that way. They're able to see and picture the shepherd going and rescuing the sheep, leaving those who are safe, going and getting the one, perhaps even carrying this sheep home, going the distance, going the extra, going, but then celebrating all that, rejoicing, I found my lost sheep. Goes on to talk about a lost coin. And a woman, she's lost what would represent a day's wages. And she's It's lost in the dust. She's sweeping the house. She's shining a light. She's trying to find. She's actively searching. In our house, we do that when we lose our keys and our phone. But we're looking. We're looking under the pillows. We're looking anywhere in the floor, anywhere in an extra bag. We're actively seeking, and we're not stopping until we find that which is of great importance. And she finds the coin and rejoices in the presence and rejoices with her friends and neighbors that they found the lost coin. What was lost was found. And a key verse in verse 10, Jesus saying, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Just as we shared this morning, just as we shared last week, one comes home, and so there's a great party, there's a great celebration. That's what Jesus is describing, what it's like in the kingdom. The next one, though, is the parable of the lost son. Let me read that together with you. I want to pull some things from this today. The parable of the lost son. Jesus continued in verse 11. There was a man who had two sons. The younger one, the baby boy, said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. Pause right here. Go back, please. In this passage, what this would mean is for the son to ask for his share of the inheritance, he's basically telling the father, I wish you were already dead. You're dead to me. That his audience understands this is greatly offensive. You're saying, just go ahead and give me my part. I mean, I get it when you die, but I wish you were already dead. I want my part. That's how offensive this would be. It's a big deal. I read that, and this is one of the two sons, and it makes me think about how pride arises, because this son has not just come to this conclusion and burst this out over breakfast. He's thought about it for a while, and that's the way it is for you and I, and anyone that battling any issue with pride. Pride begins to arise up, and you begin to think about how miserable you are. In this case, he's likely under the father's household and under the father's rules, and he doesn't like it. He's tired of the old man's ways. He's tired of the old man's rules. And I want out. I want out of the house. I remember thinking that way when I was younger. But reality is, he's got a place to live. He's got provision for his life. There's so much, even that there's an inheritance. He's got a good life. And I'm going to suggest to you today, there's many of you here today, you're teenagers and you're young adults, maybe even older adults, and you've been disrespectful to the authority over your house. You've had the same attitude. That you're tired of the father's rules. You're tired of his ideas. You're tired of his ways. And you're thinking and you're processing and pride is arising. And you're thinking all the things that you could do if you just had the resources and not the father's influence. And so you say some things that you should regret saying. Because Scripture also teaches us that we're accountable for every word that we say. Every disrespectful word that comes out of our mouth, all the coarse language that comes out of our mouth, all of the sass that comes out of our mouth, there are many times that we should be quiet, and we haven't been. And we've been disrespectful, one spouse to another. We've been disrespectful, child to parent. We've been disrespectful, brother or sister to one another. But in this case, a father's house, and I'll stick to the passage. It's pride arising. He demands his inheritance now while his father is still living. He's saying to his father, you're dead to me. And here's his Here's the way this goes. Let's pick up in verse 13. Not long after that, the younger son, again the baby boy, he got together all he had. He took his inheritance, he took his clothes, he took everything he had, and he sets off for a distant country. He's going to pack up and he's going to leave. Give me everything and I'm out of here. I'm leaving. I'm going to a distant country where you're not going to tell me what to do anymore. And there, here's what he does. He squanders his wealth in wild living. Thank you. Many of us have been there. We thought we knew better. We thought we were ready. Give me what's mine. But here's what we do with no authority in our life, no discipline in our life, no walking with God in our life, and we squander everything. We waste everything that was given to us, every opportunity that God had provided, every covering, every wonderful piece of home is gone, and it's squandered, and it's in wild living. I want you to remember that, wild living, because that's the temptation of the prideful. That pride arises, and we blow it all, and it's in wild living. You can fill in the blank with that. Sexual morality, gambling, wasteful living, no discipline at all, and that's what goes on. In verse 14, after he had spent everything, he's now completely broke, and now, guess what? There's a famine in the land, the whole country, and he's in need. Like there's a way that seems right to man, but it's not God's way. And we choose not to honor God. We choose not to honor the authority that he's placed in our life. And we go our own way, and we sow our wild oats, and then everything is gone, and all of a sudden we have need. And let's verse 15. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country. He got a job, a J-O-B. And this new employer sends him to his field to feed the pigs. Now, Jesus' audience knows this is worse than a call center, guys. Worse than having to teach. Worse than going to hot places as a missionary. I mean, this is as low as it gets. This is rough living. We're going to feed the pigs. And then as he's feeding the pigs, he longs to fill his empty stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating. He's begging, basically, and no one gives him anything. That's where you find yourself, guys, when you walk away from God. And you walk away from his provision. You walk away from his authority. You demand it all be done your way. And he'll let you do that. He'll let you make your mess. And you find yourself hungry and empty and tired and starving and out of resources and no one to give you anything and no one to call upon to help you. It's a bad place. Verse 17. When he came to his senses, that's another one to highlight. Anybody ever come to their senses? It's that wake-up call. That, oh my goodness, what have I done? I have wasted everything. I have walked away from everything. And yet he comes to his senses and he begins to think about his father's house. How many of my father's hired servants, employees, have food to spare. And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. Let me pause there for a moment. See, the first thought processes of the prideful were thinking about, well, I'd just be so much happier if I could just get out of here, but I need some resources. And so the father says, okay, I'm disrespected, but I'm going to go ahead and give that all to you. And that's the thought processes. I'm mentioning that today because it is normal to have a temptation to be prideful. But we've been talking to you for a long time, many months this year, about you taking captive the thoughts that come into your life And you could be resting upon those thoughts. You're entertaining those thoughts. You're thinking about, oh, how much happier you'd be if you were somewhere else and you had just had a little bit of resources and life would be so much better. And I'm trying to warn you today that God has a different way and a better way. Amen. And trusting that by His Spirit, He's speaking to you today. Amen. It's a word of caution. Your thought processes, it should be the alarm going off. God, help us to not entertain the thoughts, but take captive the thoughts. To take captive those things that lead us astray. To review that taking captive. Paul was telling us in 2 Corinthians 10:5, demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. There's God's way, but we start thinking about some ways that are not God's ways, and we entertain those thoughts, and it's headed toward disaster. It's choosing what we allow to take root in our mind. That's what it is to take captive. It just real simple recap. You recognize that is not from God. That's coming out. We're not focusing upon that. And we only allow those things that are godly thoughts to take root in our mind. Wild living, discontentment, unsatisfied with this life. The son thinking what he needs to be happy to move on from this life and do some wild living and have some freedom. I'm going to pause there. We're going to come back to those last verses. But that's what pride and discontentment look like. It's how it is manifest in our thoughts and the temptations that could become actions. Let me give you an image of what it's like to not walk with God. You have those two kids? You went outside of God. What else did you think would come of this? Anybody? I've been that crier. Crying to my friend. What'd you think? You heard. You knew better. God spoke to you. God intervened. God sent warning signs. God sent caution. God put people in your life. God put wise voices. But here's what this looks like down the road. This is what was the younger baby boy experiencing. Walked outside of God. That's what happens. That's what it looks like. Paul got it right in 1 Timothy 6, in verse 6, talking about godliness with contentment is great gain. Walking with God plus being content is great gain. Not just good, but great gain. Godliness with contentment. Walking with God, but also being content. Paul knew a lot about that. Philippians 4, 11 through 13. You guys may not have this, but Paul talked about learning to be content, whatever the circumstances, learning that. It didn't come naturally. It was not part of his human nature, but he learned to be content. He knew what it was to be in need, knew what it was to be in plenty, but he said he'd learned the secret of being content in every situation, whether he was fed or hungry, the basics. Whether living in plenty or in want, I can do all things who gives me strength. Philippians 4:13. We quote that one all day. I can win my ball game. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. I can hit the home run. I can kick the goal. I can get the highest grade and the best award. But see, all of that before that, the setup for that was to be content. Regardless of my circumstances. Yeah, I got some wants, I got some needs, but God, I know you're coming through for me. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me because I've learned the secret of being content in all circumstances. I've had a lot, I've had a little, but I'm here to say I'm content. Anybody else? Paul knew, and he passed that on to us. He comes to his senses. He does the math. He realizes that he needs to take responsibility for his sins and go home to his father. He's missing home. And he's wondering if home is missing him. It's what regret looks like. you're a golfer, it's wishing you had a mulligan, you had another shot at that golf ball. It's a second chance. It's a do-over. But here's what happens. And see, we tend to repent enough to be forgiven, but not enough to be changed. Did you hear me? We tend to repent enough to be forgiven, but do we surrender enough to be changed? That looks like this. Like, you know what? I got caught, and let me pray and get forgiven. I'm really sorry I got caught, but I'm sorry. But I get up, and nothing changes. And the people that are around you, the people that love you, they get tired of that. Now, your Heavenly Father, He's got grace, and He can forgive 70 times 7, but I'm not really good with that. And so if you tell me you're sorry, I'm looking for a change in your behavior, because you tell me that you're repenting of your sins and that the Holy Spirit has come to live within you. And so what that means is God living in me, I'm not going to be comfortable walking in habitual sin. I'm not going to be perfect, but I'm not going to be able to continue in a pattern of sin and feel very good about it. And so the person that I'm apologizing to, if it's my wife, my kids, my family, my friends, if I'm sorry, then they should expect, okay, we're looking for spiritual fruit, that the Holy Spirit is within you. You're the temple, and then now there's some wonderful fruit taking place here. Yeah, you're not perfect, but I can tell, they can tell whether I am walking with God or not. There's something about that. You don't have to tell me anything. I can walk into a room and be greeted by a person, and I've got enough Holy Spirit discernment at this point to know whether someone's walking with God or not. Regardless of what you tell me. Regardless of how you dress, regardless of how big your Bible is. See, pride prevents us from making an apology. Pride prevents us from accepting an apology. Pride quenches the Holy Spirit. August 20th, we were at CAG. And I delivered a word from you, and I gave you life application to say there may be some people that you need to apologize to. And I suggested even children that you might need to apologize to your parents, or parents apologizing to children, or spouses. You know, and several people came up in conversation this week asking, well, why do we talk about the application of what you shared on Sunday? Because you got to do it. You got to do it. August 20th, I got a lot of amens. But let me ask you, on this 10th day of September, did you do your homework? Because I'm not trying to share with you God's word just so you'll be entertained today. I'm trying to share with you what it is to take action in your life, embrace the Word of God, and walk in obedience, and actually take those steps, not to just be sorry, but to be changed, because the power of God is a real thing. It's real. And He comes, yes, come as you are, but He won't leave you that way. He will change you from the inside out, and you'll want to be changed, because you love God. That's what it is to love God. And yet I'm discovering that honestly, some of you don't know how to even love yourself. And perhaps if you can't even love yourself, you believe God forgave you, but you can't forgive yourself, and you can't love yourself, and your earthly father and your earthly parents or whatever you had didn't provide that for you, and you're in a place where you're struggling to love God with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength, because you don't know how to love. Repentance and humility look like returning home and finding that the Father is waiting for us, running to greet us with fullness of His love, mercy, and restoration. Let me tell you what, pick up back in the verses, pick up on verse 19 or 20 there, verse 20. So here's what happens. He comes to his senses, the baby boy. He gets up, he goes to his father. So he gets up, he leaves the country that he's at, and he goes to his father. And while he's still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son." And here's what happens. But the father said to his servants, "Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger, sandals on his feet. Bring the fatted calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate." He gets up from where he is, the son, and he goes and he leaves the country and he goes back to his father. And his expectation is, you know what, that I don't deserve to be your son anymore. But if you just hire me, I know I'll be fed. I know I'll have something. That's repentance, that's humility, and that's why I've selected this passage today. And he's not expecting what happens with the father. And I'm just going to guess that maybe you've seen this multiple times before. But I feel like today I've got to do something here to illustrate for you, because it says, like, the father, maybe he's praying for his prodigal son. Maybe he's wondering where he is. He doesn't know. Maybe he's heard some rumors, but doesn't know where he's at. And so he's constantly praying, as some of you parents have been. You've been praying for your child. You've been praying that they would come home. And we've prayed that for years. And some of you have moved from thought processes to actually living with the pigs. You've blown it all. You've lost everything. And just like this passage, you wonder, if I even go home, if I even turn to home, will I be received? Will my father even take me back? Because maybe you've been wrongly taught, even, that your theology is bad, that you've done some things that are so horrible that he would not even take you back. But the reality is that the father is looking off in the distance and praying, and he sees the son coming off in the distance. And he's filled with compassion, and he runs. And I've got to get some sons today and some daughters that will realize that this is the father running to you, to greet you, to wake you up, to welcome you home. I've read it 1,000 times, but sometimes you've got to see the reality of the scripture coming alive. The father runs to meet the son, and he's got a total different idea. Total different idea. Because Jesus set this up so beautifully, lost sheep, the lost coin, but it's all about this lost son. And it's going to be a celebration. It's a celebration. Just like he said in verse 10, all the angels in heaven rejoicing because one came home. And one came home. I share that with you today, guys, because it's pride, see, that gets in the way. Pride that tells you, you know what, you're too old to get baptized. Pride that tells you nothing's going to change. Pride that tells you we're stuck this way. Pride that gets you thinking about what it is to make you happy and make things good. Holy Spirit is very faithful to be here present with us every week. I've been praying all morning. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Because as we sang, I'm not enough. But I'm confident in a God who has changed me from the inside out and will do the same for every one of you. But you'll have to humble yourself. You'll have to humble yourself. 1 Thessalonians 5:19 through 22. I'll close with this. And I thank you for playing, Axel. John Piper had this commentary on those verses. Let me read those verses. 2 Thessalonians verse 19. Do not put out the Spirit's fire. The Apostle Paul writing. Do not treat prophecies with contempt. Test everything. Hold on to the good. Avoid every kind of evil. Piper wrote this, if the Apostle Paul himself had not warned us about quenching the Spirit, who among us would have thought it was possible? To suggest that the omnipotent Spirit of God would ever be quenched and thus restricted in what he might do otherwise in our lives and in the life of the local church is to tread on thin theological ice. God has granted the Christians the ability either to restrict or release what the Spirit does in the life of the local church. The Spirit comes to us as a fire, either to be fanned into full flame. I've seen so many Guatemalans do this so well. You build that little charcoal fire and they're just doing this. I can't even do it. Thank you. You're doing it. Got it right here, Lupe. We're fanning the flame. We're fanning the flame. We have the opportunity to fan the flame when the Spirit comes like a fire and given the freedom to accomplish His will or to be doused, watered, extinguished by the water of human fear, control, and flawed theology. That's John Piper. Guys, here's the reality. Spirit of God, faithful to show up, faithful to come. And you and I have a responsibility to fan that flame. If you want the Holy Spirit to come, and I'm trying to fan the flame. But it's water on the fire if you're going to sit here like this. Psychology 101 tells me that if I'm crossing my arms, I'm not receiving anything you're saying. And I want to caution you about closing your arms to the Spirit of God. I get it. You don't want to run around the room like I did. Be careful. But you might want to open up your hands at least. Uncross those arms and at least open your hands and say, come Holy Spirit. Come Holy Spirit. Because here, guys, here's the reality. There's a battle for your life and mine. Jesus came to seek and to save that was lost. But there's a devil, there's Satan who comes to devour. He's like a roaring lion, seeking who he may devour. That's the battle for your life and mine. It'll happen, it's happening right now. You've got voices in your head battling. You know, the old man's crazy up there. I don't know what he's doing. You got those kind of things. You got resistance because of where you come from. Some of you have some messed up religion up here. It's religion. And you've sat in it for decades. And I'm trying to be a vessel to usher in the presence of a holy God. I am not here to be a voice for religion. I am a believer just like you. I serve here as a pastor. My heart is for you, for the people. I'm not here for my gain. I'm here to see you see the Spirit of God come alive in your life. But you sit here and you hear things and you battle your emotions. You battle the past. You battle the thoughts that you allow to be in your mind and in your heart that you process and you act upon. I'm trying to wake you up. Jesus is real, guys. The presence of God is within me. He's within you. Those of you who walk with Him, those of you who call upon His name, those of you who are resting in Him today. And I'm trying to tell you, church, we may be a remnant these days. We may be a remnant. Remnant, the word remnant's like 500 sometimes in the Bible. It's a remnant. The days are evil. And yes, I'm preaching on sin, and I'm preaching on repentance, and I'm trying to prepare a bride for the return of the bridegroom. And Jesus is coming, and he's calling us to live lives of holiness. He's calling us to repent of our sins and our selfishness and our pride and to embrace humility. If anything's been of value to you today, I don't know where you're at, guys, individually. But I stand here because I believe it's all real. I believe the presence of God is real. He's faithful to show up. He's faithful to be here. Lord, I thank you today. Will you stand to your feet with me? I thank you today that you are here, that you are present, that you are worthy. Lord, I pray that you speak in the lives and the hearts of those gathered here today. You are worthy. God, that something would resonate. There may be a prodigal here. Maybe they're just in the thought processes. Maybe they thought of running. They thought of themselves. They thought of selfishness and pride. And Lord, you have arrested that today by your Spirit. I thank God for that. I thank you, Lord. Others this morning, they've gone. They've gone the way. They've left the house. They've gone their own way. And today you would call them home. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. I'm praying, Lord, that you would open blinded eyes today. That you would bring a prodigal home. That there would not be one believer in this house that could even tolerate the sin nature this morning. God, if we have failed this day even, that, Lord, your redemptive power would intercede in our lives. Your mercy and your grace would wash over us, and we would find forgiveness and healing and deliverance in the name of Jesus. Help us to know how to love you, Lord. Help us to know how to worship you with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength. Help those that need to love themselves, forgive themselves, and may this be a house of prayer. May this be a house of worship. And God, do your holy work as your holy fire would fall in this place. Come, Holy Spirit, in the matchless name of Jesus. Amen.
Down into darkness, open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you. To hear I am to worship.
Wonderful to you? Is he worthy? There are many seeking God today for various reasons, and if that's you, guys, we should never leave the house of God. If you, it's the house of God because we're here, we're vessels of God. But if you need to pray today, come and find peace with God. Prodigals, come home today. I believe we're on the verge of great revival. Even right here. And it may be that some stubborn, prideful will needs to be surrendered, needs to be laid at the foot of the cross and bow on a bowed knee. I still have a tank of water here. If you'd like to be baptized today, I'm still ready for you. I'll let them close us out, but I'm here. But you feel the freedom. Pray. Be obedient. Let's be in prayer for what God wants to do in this house, but more importantly and specifically in your life.
Access Church, we are so thankful for you this morning. We pray that you carry the Holy Spirit with you this week into your workplace, to your school, into your home, into your family. We thank you all. We look forward to seeing you again next week. You are dismissed. God bless you.